lagoons and some of the most extensive reefs in the Western Indian Ocean and some of the largest mangrove forests. But it's also a place that's difficult to live in. The arid spiny forest inland and the remote location of villages such as Andavadot mean that farming isn't an option. Instead, the majority of people that live in this village rely on fishing for income and for food. 99% of the protein that the people in this village eat comes from the sea. And this reliance on fishing, as well as increasing populations and increasing demand for seafood from international markets, has led to overfishing and the use of destructive fishing gears. International industrial trawlers are allowed in Malagasy waters, and environmental impacts such as sedimentation from runoff, from deforestation inland, and global climate change resulting in bleaching events are all having a detrimental effect on the marine environment. This isn't just about loss of habitats and threats to species, but for the people that live in Southwest Madagascar, it's also about food insecurity. These issues are compounded by poverty. Madagascar is one of the poorest countries in the world. There's a lack of access to healthcare and family planning services, and only one in three children attend school, with many of them not finishing primary school. Fishing is also incredibly culturally important to the people that live in the southwest of Madagascar. They're known as the Basin people, which is literally the thing that they shout when they are paddling their pirogues across the sea. Their way of life is completely linked to the oceans. So what's the solution to protect marine environments and the people that live there? Traditional thinking says that it's highly protected areas where no fishing is allowed. And these areas do work. When a habitat is left alone, it means that the fish stocks within it and the habitats within it can recover. And eventually, that recovery within the no-take zone spreads outside. But these no-take zones need strict enforcement. And when something is imposed top-down onto fishing communities and there is no support, they can't work. So we needed an alternative solution. When long-term thinking is a luxury and MPAs require a long... Marine protected areas can work, but they take also a long time, often many years or decades to become a solution. Instead, we needed some new thinking, and we came up with using this one new special species to show that conservation can pay. That is the octopus. The octopus is special because it's fast growing, it's highly valuable, sold to markets in Europe and East Asia, and it's also a fishery where both men and women catch the octopus. So we spoke to the fisheries, the local communities, and although they were dismissive of entire no-take reserves where no fishing was allowed because of the risk that it posed to their health, they were willing to give a go of a small octopus closure. A small area of their reef flat, about 20%, for only a couple of months, just to see what would happen. But during that octopus closure, it meant that they could fish in other areas and still feed their families and gain an income. And when that area that was closed was reopened, the results were astonishing. Octopus had been allowed to grow bigger, catches were larger, and income increased. Income increased so much that any loss that had been... Income increased so that if there was any loss from not fishing in this area, it had been far outstripped. And because we've been able to show that conservation pays, and that there were now structures in place such as committee for community governance of fisheries management, the community took it upon themselves to do more. Now in the villages around Andavadot, there are many temporary closures. There's a seasonal closure that protects breeding. and restrictions on fishing gear. And unbelievably, they also put some permanent no-take zones in place. There's now 7 in both reefs and mangrove forests. We call this an LMMA, a locally managed marine area, and it's put the fishery and its management back in the hands of the community. This idea of LMMAs, locally managed marine areas, has gone viral, and there are now LMMAs across the coast of Madagascar and even further afield. And the members of these committees have come together in networks to share ideas and experiences, and also to become a voice on the national stage. But fisheries management and things like closed areas are not enough to solve all of the issues in this area. What if a fisher wants to earn money elsewhere, but there's no opportunities to do anything else but fishing? What if a man wants to join the LMMA committee, but he can't read or write, so can't take notes back from the teen village? What if a woman wants to go to work, but she's pregnant and she has 4 children at home to look after? Or a girl wants to learn to be a midwife but has to leave school to earn money for her family? Or if local fisheries are taking the initiative and managing their resources well, but large boats like this are still allowed into their waters? This is where our other new ventures projects come in. We are working to set up seaweed farming and sea cucumber agriculture, as well as beekeeping to produce honey and mangroves as an alternative source of livelihood. We're working in mangrove forests on blue forest projects to use protected mangroves and a huge amount of carbon they sequester to create carbon credits that can be sold on the international market and then generate income for community projects. We have a crowd-funded community scholarship program which sends children to school and even university. We supplement formal education with after-school clubs such as Girls Club or Saturday School. And we run training workshops for community members to give them the skills to run their committees autonomously. Community health workers are trained to provide family planning advice and maternal health advice so that women can choose to space their births. And with our hard work, we're now recognised as experts in Madagascar. And we have the opportunity to work with government to advocate for the rights of small-scale fishers and the rights for them to manage their own fisheries. But what about those volunteers I talked about? New Ventures started as a social enterprise, with the funds from volunteer visitors going towards all of our other projects. And with a permanent base in the village, it meant that we had a sense of stability, which in turn grew to trust. The main activity of volunteers when they come to visit us is to collect data on the reefs in and around Andamadog. It's with this data that we can see changes in reef health, demonstrate the effects that things like no-take zones are having, and share that with the communities, funders, and the wider world. Without volunteers, it would be impossible to collect the amount of data that we do. Looking at our stats yesterday, I saw that volunteers had done nearly 5,000 surveys and counted over 500,000 fish. Volunteers are also important as an alternative livelihood, spending money on food and drink in local shops, on souvenirs, and hiring guides to take them on excursions. Most importantly, we run a homestay program where volunteers live and eat with local families, providing more income for their services. Volunteers are also a great asset in our education program. They help staff members practice their English and computer skills. They bring fresh perspectives and new activities to our after-school clubs. One of the favourite things about living in Andamadog is walking down the main street and having every child shout at you, "Hello, what's your name?" because you've been teaching them those phrases the previous Saturday at Saturday school. By recognising that fishing is by recognising the link between the people that live in the environment and the environment themselves, and making take a bigger picture approach and make sure that all the solutions are being included in our project plans. I'm really proud to be part of the Blue Ventures story, and I'm proud to be one of these many people that's passionate about ensuring that the marine environment and the people that rely on it are happy and healthy. Thank you for listening. You can find out a lot more about becoming part of the Blue Ventures story on our stand upstairs, and I'm sure there's several of my colleagues out in the back that will speak to you. There's loads of information on our website.